mycorrhizal fungi, and orchids. There's a lot of contradictory information out there about mycorrhizal fungi and orchids, and we're going to have to sift through it to find out what's real and what's not, so that we can also have these amazing, beautiful orchids with lots and lots of blooms. Welcome to the Nature Company. Today, mycorrhizal fungi, and we're going to try and demystify this whole thing about using mycorrhizal fungi on your orchids. There's some things that you should use, some things that you shouldn't use, and some things that are going to be okay. So let's look into all of this and see what is going to actually be best for your orchid. If this is the kind of information you're interested in, please hit that subscribe button down below and that notification bell to be notified of all our upcoming content so you don't miss out on a thing. So we've all seen a lot of people promoting mycorrhizal fungi, especially for when you're growing orchids naturally or organically. And of course, I'm one of those culprits, but I haven't explained to you exactly what mycorrhizal fungi to use or how to go about using it. So let's make sure that you've got all the information you need so that you can make your own informed decision about it. We all know already orchids have a slightly different biochemistry and metabolism to normal, if you want to call them normal plants or house plants or garden plants. They have their own particular wants and needs to grow and thrive. And how does that pertain to mycorrhizal fungi? Well, first of all, mycorrhizal fungi are those fungi that grow in and around the roots of plants, and they generally form symbiotic relationships with the plant to allow the plant to not only absorb moisture and nutrients better, but also often helps protect them against pathogenic fungi and other microorganisms that may be trying to attack your orchids. So, all plants in general. And orchids have very specific fungi that they form this relationship with. These are generally of the rhizoctonia class of fungi, and there are specific species that like to form this symbiotic relationship with your orchids. And three in particular are Thalassinella, Ceratobasidium, and Sebalina. These three, in the majority of cases, are found in conjunction with your orchids and their roots. And now I can hear you asking, what about those boxes of AMF mycorrhizal fungi, or those things called glomus? Can I use those? We'll get to that in a bit, because this is where the contradictory information comes in. Some of these are not suitable for your orchids, but let's first look at the ones that are. These rhizoctonia type fungi that your orchids particularly like are the fungi that it actually requires in the wild to actually germinate the seed. So what happens is, as these fungi grow, they produce these tubes called hypha, and these land up forming these circular spiral sort of clumps of these tubes, and this is where the fungus stores all its nutrients. So it will store all those ready nutrients for continued growth. And what happens then, the orchid starts to digest these spiral hypha and uses the nutrients there to grow. And this is what gives the initial seed the boost and the seedlings the energy and the nutrients to allow for them to start growing properly. Often as the plant ages, the orchid becomes less and less reliant on these fungi to actually produce food for them, because they start to produce enough leaves and enough leaf volume to photosynthesize properly. This doesn't mean that this symbiotic relationship stops there. Often they'll still keep those fungi in the roots of the plant to still help supply it with both nutrient and moisture during those drier periods, because these fungi actually help the plant retain moisture during drier periods, and the plant then absorbs it from the fungi slowly over that period. Until, of course, the weather comes back, you get the rain, and the plant can survive again by itself. But that does not mean that these fungi did not play a vital role in the maintenance of the orchid's health during that dry spell. Also, being in the roots, they help fight off or outperform pathogenic bacteria or fungi that may be trying to cause root rot, because they now have the space and they're using up the energy, so there's nothing left for these pathogenic fungi to feed on. They'll help reduce the amount of soft rot that happens in your roots. But remember, not all orchids have such a close relationship with these rhizoctonia fungi. There's some of the terrestrial orchids that particularly do like a lot of them, and their whole root system is based around having these mycorrhizal fungi around. Some of them are actually completely dependent on them. Others just require a large amount of them to help boost the plant enough to continue growing well. And then others, especially those epiphytic orchids, don't necessarily need them at all after a specific point in their growth. But orchids, especially Cattleya and Phalaenopsis, do actually enjoy having these mycorrhizal fungi around their root systems. And in most modern growing systems, these mycorrhizal fungi no longer exist. For one, they won't grow properly in non-organic media. Inorganic media such as rocks and lava rock, there's going to be very little space for them to grow. There's probably not enough humidity. There's no organic matter for them to stay alive on long enough. Also, with all these chemical or synthetic feeds, the salt contents of these are generally too high. This will then form an environment in your media that is not right for their growing. So they're not going to thrive, and your orchid then won't be able to absorb them up into the roots. They are actually only going to be absorbed into the roots through either the root tip or through cracks, micro cracks, or small damaged parts of the velamen itself, because it is not absorbed into the velamen. It will also be absorbed through any of those passage cells that are available to it and enter your orchid that way. It doesn't live in the velamen at all. It actually moves its way all the way into the cortex, and that's where it settles itself in. But only in localized areas. It's not a systemic fungus that will then spread out through your whole plant. It just stays in a small localized area around that specific root that it started to inhabit. It just enters those cell membranes around the cortical cells and doesn't actually enter the cytoplasm at all. And that's where those little hypha that I told you, those spiral hypha that I told you about, are formed. And then the plant then decides, I'm going to dissolve that and use it myself. So it's a continual reinfestation, if you want to put it that way. It's a cycle of dying and being reborn and reinfecting. So that's basically what happens inside those tiny minute little cells inside the roots. And that's what helps your orchid survive. So whether it's symbiotic or not seems to be a bit more dodgy when you look at it that way, that the plant is then just deciding to dissolve and digest the fungus. Although it does give it a living area and occasionally feeds it with sugars. So there is that little bit of symbiosis involved there. So which orchids are specifically suited to having mycorrhizal fungi added to them? Well, as I said, Cattleyas, Phalaenopsis, Cymbidiums particularly like mycorrhizal fungi. But again, you have to be aware that you're not putting those mycorrhizal fungi that people use for their vegetables and garden plants. Because although it is often considered a terrestrial plant, it's still an orchid. You're still looking for those rhizoctonia that can form symbiotic relationships with your orchid. Also, most of the other terrestrial orchids like to have mycorrhizal fungi present in and around their root system. So generally, it's a good idea to add it to all of your terrestrial orchids. And remember, some of them are highly dependent on them. And how do I go about getting my mycorrhizal fungi onto my orchids, especially if they potted? Well, for one, often the best time to do it is at repotting. You can then dip your roots of the plant into your mycorrhizal fungi solution and allow it to sit in the solution for 10, 15, 20 minutes or so. Then again, remember, we don't want to leave those roots underwater for too long, but give it enough time so that it can absorb some of those mycorrhizal fungi in through that root tip and those passage cells. When you're using new media, you can soak the media in a mycorrhizal fungi solution, or sprinkle some of that powder in and around your media. Not necessarily just on top, but into the media itself, because what's on top may just dry out. So try and get that into the media so that it's got a moist and humid enough environment that it can continue to grow, and that the plant can still absorb it into it. And for mounted orchids, if your orchids are on a bark or cork mount, or a different type of mount that perhaps has some sphagnum moss in behind it, then it's really easy to do. You can just dunk it into your solution and let it sit there as if it was a bare root plant, absorbing in some of those mycorrhizal fungi. And to allow these fungi to proliferate, remember, you have to keep your humidity levels up for long enough. So at least for a month, keep the humidity in and around your plant up. Make sure it's moist enough, but not soggy. If it's too soggy, you're just going to drown those fungi and they won't survive. If it's too dry, they'll just dry up, because they are really, really fine, tiny little particles. And being so small and fine, they take quite a while to actually proliferate. So giving them at least a month in those nice humid conditions to allow them to grow well. And that way they can be absorbed and taken up into your plant and start their magic. So you can see, using mycorrhizal fungi is not an instant fix to anything. It's a slow process that will help then build up the resilience and strength of your plant itself. In big, beautiful plants like this, if you're now just adding mycorrhizal fungi for the first time, you may not notice any difference whatsoever. They may not produce more leaves than they are producing already, or grow faster, or any of that, but you will notice they'll probably be less affected by disease and other fungi. Also, you'll notice that they are more resilient to stress, whether it's heat, cold, whether it's dehydration, all of that, your plants will have more resilience. They'll have built up a stronger system to be able to withstand any of those troubles. But then again, remember, you need an organic media or semi-organic media for these to really proliferate. So something like bark with sphagnum moss, or anything like that that's going to hold that little bit of extra moisture, allow space for that mycorrhizal fungi to grow and proliferate. Give it moisture and humidity and an environment that it can continue its proliferation. And if you're using synthetic or chemical plant foods, the salts in them are going to actually kill your mycorrhizal fungi. It's going to produce an environment where they just can't grow. So you may have to use very low dosages of those chemical fertilizers. Also, of course, naturally, fungicides and other strong chemicals are going to kill them off quickly. So if you're wanting to keep your mycorrhizal fungi, you're going to have to avoid using fungicides and use your cultural practices and the benefits that those mycorrhizal fungi bring to avoid a too bad a fungal outbreak. What in particular do these mycorrhizal fungi bring for your plant? Well, they bring increased phosphorus and nitrogen uptake. So the plant has more phosphorus for better, stronger flowering, and more nitrogen available for stronger vegetative growth. They also help reduce loss of water through the roots during those drier periods. So it means that there's more moisture available to the plant itself, making it more able to withstand droughts or dry periods. And also in those low nutrient or nutrient deficient conditions that orchids are generally found in the wild, they help stimulate not only root growth, but top growth as well. So it's almost helping maintain the balance in your auxins and cytokinins to producing signals to allow the plant to grow better. And then again, supplying it with that extra phosphorus and nitrogen, especially to help continue the growth. And now what about those mycorrhizal fungi packs we can buy online that say for your houseplants or for your vegetables to get bigger, brighter, redder tomatoes, or just to get better root growth on your pot plants? Are those going to work for our orchids? No, not particularly. A lot of the fungi that are involved in those mycorrhizal fungi will probably be able to outcompete the mycorrhizal fungi that the orchids need. Those rhizoctonia may not be able to compete for the resources as successfully as, for instance, glomus, which is one of the common ingredients in these mycorrhizal packs, which is actually a very vigorous, fast-growing fungus that most common houseplants will form symbiotic relationships with in their roots. But it's not going to work for orchids. It's going to be using up those nutrients and not necessarily making them available to your orchids at all. Your orchid may not derive any benefits that they would have otherwise if they could have formed that symbiotic relationship. So although by using these, you may land up with a nice environment in your pot itself, which will help deter pathogenic fungi and bacteria, it may not be providing your plant with any specific nutrient benefits or any specific hydration benefits. So you may just be reducing your plant's chance of infection. And even with those terrestrial orchids, those same mycorrhizal fungi that are needed for your epiphytic orchids are needed for those terrestrial ones. So the same with these packs. They're not going to provide the same benefits to your orchid as what the rhizoctonia type fungi are going to do. So it's probably better not to add them at all because it could outcompete any of those symbiotic bacteria that your orchids need and not allow them to flourish enough to form the relationship with your orchid that is needed. And then it comes to trichoderma. These are not actually mycorrhizal fungi. They're just root zone fungi. So they are actually beneficial to use. They are still going to provide you or your orchid the same positive benefits that they would if you're using them on houseplants and that. They're going to help outcompete the pathogenic fungi and bacteria, providing with a smaller chance of your plants becoming infected. This is going to help reduce the chance of your plants getting Phytium or Fusarium because this trichoderma does a really good job at outcompeting them. And they also act as root stimulators. So it's going to help produce a stronger root system for your plant, which is actually going to make it a stronger plant, which makes it more likely to be able to fight off diseases and infections. Especially in terrestrial orchids, it helps with the resilience of your plant, helping it overcome stressful conditions like drought, heat, cool, or infections. So trichoderma is still one that you can use on all of your orchids. So remember, even with mounted orchids, the mycorrhizal fungi, by colonizing the roots, make the roots themselves less susceptible to water loss. And this is especially important for mounted orchids. With no media around them to supply them with extra moisture, they're out open to the air and can dry out relatively quickly. So this is no small advantage of having mycorrhizal fungi on your mounted orchids. I know with all these complicated names, it can be a little bit difficult to remember everything. So Ed will post up in that Buy Me a Coffee link everything you need to know about this video. And if you have found any of the information we've provided in any of our videos helpful and want to show appreciation, you can buy us a coffee down there too. Don't forget, you can also sign up, become a member, and grow like a pro. If I don't seem to have explained anything properly, drop us a comment in the comments box below and I'll be sure to get back to you. And thank you for watching. If you found any of this information helpful, please hit that like button, hit that subscribe button, and that notification bell, bing bong, to be notified of all our upcoming content so you don't miss out on a thing. Help us grow as we help your orchids grow.